and then pull the pressure field like using Kazaki filters, you can single out of this force due to the head loss, due to the seepage. At each point, because basically it's a hydraulic gradient, the gradients, it's times unit weight that give you the force for that particular volume, what we call seepage force. But that's a cluster in the effective stress framework. But very often people will say, oh, you don't consider about seepage force. Even this debate, even today, people will still try to debate and say, oh, you don't consider about seepage force. The other one will say, oh, it's already included. You can see that. And in fact, it is. If you use the effective stress principle, you don't even worry about seepage force. It's there. Because whenever you calculate the pore pressure field, it has the seepage there. Each point of why there is let's say point A and point B, why originally, before there's any seepage, let's say that between A and B, the head has 1 meter differences. Okay, so that means there's some flow. But after you have infiltration, there's a head difference is 10 meters. And that causes an additional what we call seepage force. In fact, that head difference is also, you have to think about it, that the suction stress is different, or pore pressure is different, and then effective stress will be different. But the connection is not that obvious. And in fact, it's a question, as I said, even recently I reviewed some people still try to reinvent the wheel, double counting, both of them. In fact, it's the same. So I'd like to focus right now to talk about the final talk that we put together. In fact, you see that even though right now I'm kind of synthesizing what I talk about, effective stress, health slope hydrology, stress and material property, and putting the framework of slope stability. Our framework, once you understand some of the additional part than the classical, it's extremely simple. All you need to do is just replace the forward pressure by suction stress. So the final part is one of the, I mentioned that one of the things that, in my view, that prevent us to go from engineered slope to natural slope prediction, it is the kind of current paradigm using the limit analysis. Because as I show you, we are assuming the failure surface has a certain geometry, which I believe it never occurred in the reality. Because in the reality, once you have even the homogeneous material, the failure surface is never, because never nobody is going to remember what is the failure surface. It's all kind of conception, you know, roughly about this. The second one is where it start to fail. Is it a hole? Is it in the middle or cluster? And very few work documents scientifically to investigate that one. Partially, most of the time after failure, okay, you see that there's a crack, that is a shape of the failure. So where to start and how to progress, I think this is something that was not in the original, which is geomechanics, geotechnical design framework, or we call it limited analysis. So I personally believe that we need to break that paradigm. In other words, how we can analyze the slope to see where is the most vulnerable region. And then, you know, if that happened, where to start? And once it starts, and where it's going to progress. So that's something that I think that we have to think about. And so this is the second part that I think in our framework, the ingredient is to be able, I would say, to identify the weak region. I wouldn't say that we are in the stage to completely understand once it starts, how you progress, but we can, a framework can tell you what are the areas where it's the most vulnerable, and then roughly geometry where it is. And I say so, I can show you some of the results compared to classical. So this talk basically last hour, we're divided into several parts. One is the what we call the hydromechanical framework. In many cases, it's very similar to what Ricardo has done, what Christina has done, the hydromechanical. We all know that, understand that, importance of hydrological as well as the stress distributions. And what we propose is what we call the scalar field of factor safety. Well, what I mean scalar is like each point you define one factor safety. It's not like a stress, it's a vector field, because each point you have to define the tensor in three dimensions and the vector in two dimensional case. But in this case, it's just like a head. Each point has that one head, so each point we can define factor safety. I'll show you how we define it. And then transient slope stability analysis, which is beyond what we make assumption called infinity slope model. Because the infinity slope model, we never know exactly the stress distribution in the slope. We make assumption certain pattern is going to be. It's basically assuming that the fate is a pair of us. So. But that could be true, but still cannot answer the question. Most cases, it's not infinity. It's mostly infinity, but there's also a wedge on the surface, on the toe area. So where the star, you have to go to that accuracy, you know, be able to calculate. And I will use a few cases to illustrate this framework. The first one is using Seattle, where UHS and school mine, we have over decades of monitoring. Eventually, we'll be able to, I would call the first time, we'll be able to scientifically document the site, monitor for a decade, and eventually landslide occur. So we have all the data up to the moment, at the point where the material fell, how the hydrological behavior is. So that case I'll show you, and then use this framework to back accurate reconnaissance to see whether the framework is correct or not. And the second case I will use in Colorado, where we have a snow melting, and most likely people go to Colorado, you know that we have a beautiful mountain, and the snow actually never melt in the winter. But the springtime, when it starts to temperature to rise, it can melt within a week or two. So accumulate a couple of feet of a couple meters of the snow, just suddenly melt. It's just like a heavy precipitation. And when that happens, you know, it causes a lot of landslide. So I've used these two cases somewhere to validate or to field study our framework. Again, I'd like to start with the illustration of the failure mode. As you see, the material failure for a slope, if you really look from the mechanical point of view, what I mean is that we call it equilibrium. What we mean here, I want to make clarify that, because by conversation with students, some people say if you do a landform evolution model, you talk about equilibrium in a million years or 100,000 years. What we mean the mechanical equilibrium is almost instantaneous. In other words, if something, let's say, you see this, some crack start to develop, or if you put a car over the highway, if you want to sense a 10 meter below the highway, it's almost instantaneous. It's actually at the speed of a wave propagation. So it's you know, maybe a fraction of seconds. Whatever way you put a car on the top of the highway, and 10 meters below that, you're going to sense that. So that's kind of equilibrium we are seeking. So we're not looking for dynamic equilibrium, because if you do a dynamic equilibrium, if you look at the equilibrium equation, you have to add an inertial term called fictitious force, Newton's second law. But we talk about a static case. So it's instantaneous almost in equilibrium. So if you use that framework, then you know, if you look at the slope, let's say this is assumed the likely slope for the some kind of what we call deep sea landslide. Typically you will see, if you do a stress analysis, say total stress due to gravity, you will find that near the crust area, sometimes it's compressive, sometimes it could be tensile. But in the middle of the slope, the stress is more likely like this, so it's a shear. So this is a promotion because the principal stress, maximum and minimum, reach the largest differences between two of them. And that means that more circle has the largest diameter, all the shear stress is most vulnerable. But here, also could be, but here, this is what we call in the term of geomechanics, we call the active case. The active will come from the, it's vertical dominating. It's not perfect vertical, but it's vertical dominating, which means gravity is the major principal stress reason. But here comes what we call a passive failure. Passive means horizontal is bigger. So this is not a perfect horizontal, but dominating the principal stress horizontal, which means you're pushing from the, in the geology, the structure geology is like one is called a normal form, one is called a reverse form. If you have a tectonic horizontal, you push it big, and you will see that this angle is almost like a, from the vertical is 45 degrees plus a half angle. So now a low angle form, if you see the geology. But if you have the vertical stress as principal gravity in the rift basin, you're going to see the 45 degree or the steeper plus the half average angle form. So it's a similar situation in a little slope that you have this active case and passive case. And that tells us actually this failure surface in the middle of the slope is almost about 60 degrees. Because the half of the friction angle, 45 degrees plus half the friction angle, which is about 30 divided by and it also tells you that the slope of the failure here, the failure surface is almost in a low angle form. So there's some similarity between the what we talk about the failure of the slope and the structure of the form. So with that, let's talk about this theory of stress. So this diagram illustrates the differences between the limit analysis and the equilibrium stress field analysis. I want to explain a little bit. So if you look on the left side, that particular diagram, if you look at the several of the failure surfaces, those are all the classical methods I showed you before. If you use a Bischoff, if you use a Coleman's, if you use a Yambo's, a Ordinary, or Morgenstern Price, different method, the method of slide, you will calculate that the most vulnerable surface are all those lines, dashed lines. And the factor safety in this case is the calculate other than Coleman's method and the global method, which is use a finite element method, is greater than one. The rest of three, four methods, they all say this slope is not stable. Now, if you look at the stress of state around the, let's say we do around the ABC3 point, which is the surface that all these four methods say that it's not stable, and you plot the state of stress at the 3 point, and there are only 1 point, this diagram is not very clear, which is above the failure surface, which is almost impossible. But the rest of the 2 point is below this envelope, which means the other 2 point, the B and the C, are never failed. Never failed. It's only 1 point that's greater than that one. But if you look at the capital stress field, which is in the chart that have a total stress field, and then you can calculate the module field, and then exact stress field, you calculate the exact stress field, the 3 point, you put into this diagram, all of them touch the failure surface. But this failure surface is not those determined by the classical method. This failure surface is by local factor safety. We're equal to 1, so this is the counter of local factor safety 1. You just look at this 3 point. All the points in shape, if the calculation is 1.0, they fail. So, and the failure surface, there are a lot of similarity compared to the classical one, as you see the larger portion, there's certain kind of, but they are also different in some, particularly in the torque area for this particular slope. So what I want to make sure is the stress field based failure surface is determined based on the state of stress and the local factor safety, which you measure every point along the failure surface reach the limit equilibrium. So you can think about, instead of make assumption, so because I think that a lot of the things it's missing, and this missing part actually is for engineering purposes very good, because we never design our slope, say I give a factor safety 1.2 or 1.3, and the design code always say you have to give 1.6, 1.7. If you design different earth structure like a retaining wall, you have to give like a 2.0, 2.5, depending on the code. And that additional one is what we cover, where we don't know. But if we want to go beyond the engineering thinking, rather than to predict the slope, you open your eyes to see that, we needed that additional one. That additional one is the one that we are pursuing right now. And I think that to calculate the stress is the way to do it. So the stress field, finite element, as I illustrated here, for example, you can, once you know the what is your boundary, boundary geometry, condition, material property, you actually can calculate precisely the three, each point you can calculate the three components, the x components, the y components, and the shear components. Of course, you can also portray in the principal stress, because each point you can rotate to the direction where you don't have the shear stress. So that can be converted to that one. But what we concern, as I said, that the earth material most vulnerable is the shear. So what we concern is what we call sometimes the limitory, which basically is a maximum shear stress related. It's the difference between the principal stress. So if you do that, now let me say the framework we have been trying to work on. Why I say so, that the framework has been built, it's not a new, it has been, even the people here has tried to build it. It's a subject that we have a geomorphological model, and which people use, because in particular today's technology, that we get a very good GIS data, vegetation data, we get a climate data. And once we have that model built, this is not new, but this is depend on what kind of model you use. And we have hydrological model. Hydrological model, again, is not a new. In this case, we only consider about the Richards equation, which is the matrix flow. But of course, people can extend that one, use a similar concept to build a hydrological model to account for what happened in the health slope. But I just use the Richards equation as an example. And in this framework, as we know, that we need two parameters, or two characteristic functions for the material. And that's called a hydrological model, where we need to have two parameters. With that, we know that we will understand the transient distribution of moisture suction in the hill slope under the precipitation. Once we know that, then we can go back to the classical distress model. But again, this model is the same. You know, I use the simplest called linear elastic theory, equilibrium equation, stress-strain relation, displacement, strain relation. Those are just examples. A framework does not have to be limited, but it's a starting point to illustrate that. And those things are the same. But what we added is, if you pay attention to that, is the in Hooke's law or in the stress relation, we use effective stress. In other words, what makes a deformation permanent, it is the skeleton or the effective stress. And that requires the suction stress. And that's why I put the suction stress there, the hydromechanical of the suction stress there. And then framework, we do another stress somewhat similar to what the classical is. The difference is that we move beyond the one slope of one factor safety. We try to fully use what we calculate the stress anyway. We use the stress to calculate the effective stress, and we can calculate the local factor safety at each point. So that is our framework. If I want to summarize, I use it's a two green bubble. One is we fully accurately calculate the stress or the effective stress in partially saturated material. And that has to come from the hydrological information. That's why I put this one-way couple. The second thing is, how we can deal with the slope stability analysis, we're going to use, instead of the one step of one factor safety, we're going to calculate the field. And that gives us a better idea about how the slope is going to fail. So we can use this example some example compare with the classical one, because everybody will ask how good it is. So this is several methods I don't already talk about, so we don't need to. So let's come back to the part that we define local factor safety. How we define that? So here is the illustration. Supposedly you have a stable stress under the slope at a particular point. It's just like exactly like this. And you have the failure surface envelope like that. So you know that this point is not going to fail because it's away from the failure surface. But in fact, you can, for that information, so the key is I'm here, this is my limit. How far I'm away from limit? You have to create some kind of indicator. And so here's how we create an indicator. It's because if you want to say what's the most vulnerable plane, it's going to have a failure. It is this plane. It is perpendicular to that. And that around that plane, what is your current stress, which you project to the shear? And what is that maximum one that reaches that? And that stress actually has a term in structural geology called, and people are doing an earthquake prediction, or they call it Coulomb stress. So basically, around the Coulomb failure plane, where you have that, it's basically can become on the center and then connect to perpendicular to this failure. So it's called Coulomb stress. So in fact, you see that the vertical two intersection, they give you a very good indicator to see how far it away from the failure. From the current one. So this is exactly how we could define the local factor safety. So because here if you do a simple geometry, you will come up with the local factor at each point. It has a two parameter, which is a coefficient friction angle. That's a classical one. And then you need to know the principal stress. In particular, it's effective stress. Nothing else more. But to know the principal effective stress, you need to know the suction stress, because suction stress is part of defining effective stress. So the ratio, after all, it's basically come down to each point. Once you calculate a state of stress, a particular effective stress, then you will be able to determine that point. So it's a very simple algorithm, the formula, and I can use that to write it as basically the form for each point. So we can do point by point. And the suction stress, you can calculate based on the field of the matrix suction. And also you can calculate the field of moisture content and saturation, because the moisture content and saturation the moisture content and the matrix suction are correlated by slow modification. So let's look at how this method compares with the classical method. First, let's look at the slope where it's either completely dry or saturated. So there's nothing to do with partially saturated suction stress concept. What I show you is a vertical cut. So we do this vertical cut slightly different than you see the vertical cut. Then we define what we call the slope stability number, which basically is the ratio of the cohesion and the maximum stress. So to look at how you look at that, or if you look at on the right side, there is the shaded area and the street line, those are by the classical method. Sorry, they can't see too clear about each of the method calculate the factor of safety.
Jack is not very clear, but
those numbers are important. But anyway, those slope in this case is the fail. The factor safety actually is greater than 1. But if you use our method, you can see that the contour equal to 1, which is on the left side is a computed contour based on the stress field. So the contour equal to 1, I single out on that area. As you see that, that is the failure of the particular slope. So there is some similarity in this case compared to the geometry of the classic one, but there's also quite different. Particularly, for this case, it's basically evolution. As we go to a slope, become stronger and stronger. When slope becomes stronger and stronger, it's less and less likely that this first three case to fail. But our methods, in particular, this part of failure, that's a little bit bigger. And the classical method will not predict this slope to fail. In our way, it will be standard. So that is and then you can also do say, okay, if I use that slope, let's say the factor of safety equal to 1, I can remove it. So this is the case where this slope stand there. I use this case. And I take this part out. If I take this part out manually, just simply, to recalculate the stress field, and then it will be another contour which is equal to 1. And you get another contour. So after this simple several iteration, you see that this is where the slope is going to stay stable. So that is the shape actually more close to what you observe in the reality of the shape. So you can do this iteratively. Of course, you can do by computer algorithm, but we just illustrate the user manually to see that whatever the factor safety equal or less than 1, take the material out. Because once you take it out, the stress field will be different because the material itself has certain weight, right? So you do that by several iterations, you will see that eventually you can see some kind of slope. It was not very clear projected here, it's basically like this kind of shape slope after several iterations. So here we show that for the vertical car, particular given, the classical method will say that slope is stable. In our case, it's not stable, it's going to be some configuration. And this is a 60 degree slope. It tells a similar story. So this is actually this project is a little bit better in terms of numbers. So I want to say a little bit. So for example, even the first the slope actually is the weakest slope. Now same kind of geometry, you just change the coefficient. You only think about the difference between the first one, second one, third one is as a progress, the coefficient increase. So which means the slope become more stable. The classical method in the first case it predicted about 1.0. That's slope failure. But our method actually, see 1.0 is a different shape than the classical one. So that is the first one. Now as the slope gets more stable and stronger, the classical method all predicted factor safety greater than 1. You know, somewhere in this case 1.8, 1.28, 1.4, somewhere range that one. But our method is predicted as a slope failure in the local. Near the curve, above the curve area. And same thing for this, as you increase the coefficient, all the classical methods, you see that 1.5, 1.7, all this range, but our method show that this notion is already starting to fail. And by the time, the same thing for this slope. And it's so strong, it's both 1.8, 1.9, all this slope, and our method say, okay, this curve area actually has a regional, it's starting to fail. Now, this one, if you look at it reversely, let's say the slope starts very strong because of infiltration, because of the weathering process, the material stress becomes weaker, weaker. What do you expect it to progress? So you can see that the original here and then gradually progress. At some point, it's going to completely fail. So that is the illustration of that. 45 degrees is a similar story. If you go through that one, it's a classical method will predict very differently than what we have in here. The difference is ours is accurate. I can guarantee you because it's a contour of factor safety equal to 1, so it's precisely use the stress information you use for numerical method to calculate the factor safety. That contour now exactly value equal to 1, the factor safety, it will be fair. So that is the difference, and the difference is pretty huge. In fact, if you look at the classical method calculator, where they start to break down. In fact, it's about 1.7, 1.8. That's actually the magically it's a design in many of the country. The slow steady design code that you have to compulsory say you have to do at least a minimum 1.5, 1.6, because that's a fine empirical. But what I say is that if you design less than 1.5, your failure according to this calculation, you slope already start to have a local failure. It does not mean they have a large and catastrophic failure. So some will relate to, you know, can be confirmed by the some kind of engineering experience. What's interesting is if you look at the slope a little more gentle, so this is a 30 degree slope. And when you find out here, this is a slope without the infiltration, just a saturated or dry, you see that the vulnerable area starts to be a shallow. See this one, contour 1.5. And the classical method is all greater than 1.0. But the method we calculate is this kind of shape. So, and very interesting. Oh, this is a 1.5. So this slope will not fail, but the slope will not fail, but it's close to 1.0 still. The first one is going to fail. So that is the difference. So let's look at one of the slopes. Say, okay, if we have this particular shape, I want to say a little bit. It's very interesting. For example, this contour is telling you that there's a two area which is very vulnerable for a slope. What are they? One is the shallow. The other one is deep. So if you have an infiltration which is predominant in the shallow, this portion can go. On the other hand, if you have a water infiltration down here, as they go down to deep, this portion can also become weaker. So in the Whitby Island of Seattle offshore, I think that the reason they have a 1 month is because there's definitely a deep infiltration. You know, when they pass the period where they can reach one in the shallow end, and then they go to this part. When this part becomes weak, you can have this larger scale, the length line. So this is what we are. And we can actually use a hydrological model. Now let's do a little bit of experiments and use a numerical to put it at 30 degree slope and start to give an infiltration. In this case, I give a 5 days infiltration to see how this, of course, infiltration rate is nearly saturated, but slightly less than saturated, and to see this 5 years, what's the consequence of the this hill slope in terms of the everything that we wanted interested. So let's look at this infiltration scenario. First, we can look at the water content. So this is the hydrostatic, we're assuming hydrostatic water content. If you're familiar with that, the dark one is about 100% saturated, which is like 0.45 velocity, and then the white one is zero. And as water infiltrate, you see that it gradually penetrate, movement down. And you know, this is 12 hours, 2 days, 5 days, and so on and so forth. And we simulate that, we just show some of the 5 years of contour. Now, if you cut the middle of the slope, just look at how this dynamic changes, so I can cut in the middle of the slope to see how the profile changes. So this is the profile changes of water content. The solid line, only vertical, which is hydrostatic before the rainfall. And once you have rainfall, the shallow start to increase the water content, but gradually migrate. After 5 days, the rain stop, but water continue migrating. Even the 5 years, they have not recovered for this particular soil. And corresponding, what is the suction chain? Initially, hydrostatic is this line. And the suction stress, and the factor safety. Now, this project is not very good, but if you look at it carefully, this is the area, this is one. So for this particular slope, 30 degrees, you will have like about 30 centimeter where actually the slope start to fail. Now the local factor safety, less than one. And then if we compare, if we don't do this finite animal, we just use the infinite slope model. So this is what the infinite slope predicted. One of the problems of the infinite slope model, people know that. In fact, because in the denominator, you have the weight of soil, Z, coordinate there. So when Z becomes small, factor safety becomes very high. So if you use a classical infinity slope model, it always almost predicts a very high, very shallow, very high factor safety. And so that's what shown here. So the factor safety is very high. Now even though you use our model, it will go back a little bit because of precipitation, but still. So this is somewhat unrealistic about the infinity slope model in this case. But if you use the local factor safety, we predict this much. And this is better to look at it if we look at the entire field. So let's look at this entire field. This is the suction stress field. And somewhat similar to the moisture and as it progresses, suction stress disappears. And this is the local factor sink. So we come to a local factor sink venture. You see that time zero for the 12 hours. And when it's goes to 12 hours, the shallow reach minimum about 1.25, still above 1. And 2 days, still the surface starts to reach 1. And then 5 days, you see all this dark area. That is a factor safety in the mount areas. So which means, and after that, of course, we don't take the material out. We just say, okay, we stop to see how they recover in the drying process. So they gradually recover, very thin slides of the one, and they eventually disappear. So that is the factor safety, local factor safety concept I use. Basically, use this concept. So maybe right now I want to quickly use two cases to illustrate this example. Some of you are probably familiar because we have published a number of papers based on this site, because this is the site we most under most intensive study of the U.S. Geological Survey's landslide team. And it all started with the 90s. In fact, there's a lot of problems in Seattle area. If you're not familiar, you're not familiar with yourself with the U.S. map, and there on the northwest corner is the state of Washington. Above that is Canada, the city of Vancouver is right on the north of that. And Seattle is in the Bay Area, in the northwest corner of the state. And the particular city is Seattle here. And around this stretch of line, it's called the Puget Sound, which has a railway. If you look at the railways, cross section is like this. This is the railway track, and this is the bluff where we the glacier deposit. Very sandy material. But the slope is quite steep. In the natural environment, it's about 45 degrees. Partially, I think there's a lot of ice, you know, a couple of kilometers of ice in the ice age compact of the sand. So they somewhere actually interlock. So there is some kind of high frictional angle that actually make the materials slope quite steep. And this is what the map was showed before the landslide and after the landslide. And here's, if you look from the top, ultimately we capture this little landslide. And we have a scientific instrumentation of the model that go all the way to the bedrock at a different depth. And you look up from another view, this is the railway track and the Puget Sound, and then our monitoring site, the red part is where the little landslide occurred. So here, again, we can digitize the interfinite element, and we treat a different material based on the geological study. And here's the infiltration record. Of course, we collected over a decade, but this just showed before, 3 months before the landslide, all the way after the landslide, which occurred January 14 of 2006. And so this from September, as you see that in Seattle area, sometimes the rain, sometimes stop. And then by December, it's almost a non-stop rain for a few weeks. And that is where the, after a certain period, that's what the most vulnerable period in the December, later or January. And the cumulative amount, even looking from September, it's almost about 0.5 liter of water dumping to the ground slowly. And we characterize the material properties. So as I said, what are those? So the characteristic curve. So for all those sites with different soil, different rock, actually we characterize hydraulic conductivity function, so the retention, and we calculate the suction stress for those material based on the measurement. And so here are the site simulation or transient simulation. And firstly, you can see that water content. So this is the water content using the infiltration model. If you try to figure out, the blue one is a high water content and the red one is a dry. So initially, the top is the middle is quite dry, and then start to have a shallow a little bit. And this is at November, after September, October, November, you see that the progressively shallow material start to get wet and wetter. And by the December, January, they are nearly saturated, but still not saturated. And here's the corresponding cold water pressure, which is a negative. You see the start with no rain, and then start with a gradually change of the cold water pressure. Most of them are near the shallow environment. It's almost less than zero. Now we see the tensile of zero. And here's the vertical, in the middle, you look at the profile, you can see how the water content change at a different time, how the simulation result, how the cold water pressure or negative cold water pressure change. So what's the next one? You can calculate suction stress, because we know the moisture content transient, we know the suction transient, you can calculate the suction stress. And here you see that there are certain areas that after a certain time, the suction stress become quite small. And the most interesting is the, of course, there's a, you can calculate vertically in the middle of the slope, what's the suction stress, what's the factor safety. If you blew up that one, you can see that this very shallow region where the factor safety is less than one. But if you come to a type two-dimensional cross section, this is more illustrative. And you can see that the September, there's a very little, if we blow up that slope, there's a very little tiny area where actually reached the 1.0. But still there, and then October, there's quite a bit. And then November, December, by December, you see that this very shallow area is entirely, if we blow up this one, it's equal to 1. And then January, eventually, we have a landslide. So you can see that this is a simulation, which in fact is quite well confirmed. In fact, if you pay attention to how much the suction stress is going to change in this slide, it's only changed about 5 to 10 kPa. Very small amount of suction near the surface, suction stress changing. It's going to cause a landslide. And we use this local factor safety concept, as you see, that they can actually reproduce what we observe in the field. So I'd like to talk about the last case. The last case is what we've done in Colorado. So this is the case in the US. We have called the Interstate Highway. Interstate Highway could be north, south, and east, west. And everybody familiar with the system will know that if you have an even number, which means the east, west, and odd number is north, south. And I-70 is about the middle of the country. It crosses almost the entire continent from east coast near Baltimore and then to the Atlantic Ocean to west. So it passed Colorado, so it's one of the very important. And Colorado, as you know, a little bit about Colorado, it's a continental divide. It's the highest elevation state in the lower portion of the United States. And a lot of area actually is covered by snow on the top year long. So this is the I-70. If you look at the I-70, look at the east, directly look at the east. And here is the highway. And this is the patch where it has a landslide. So what happens is they have a tunnel. This tunnel is right here, across continental. It's called Eisenhower Tunnel. And that tunnel is the highest in the continental US. When they built the tunnel in the early 70s, they have lots of material. They need to dump, and that's part of the build this highway. Cut a little bit of road, and then they put some of the material there. And this is the portion of the material. If you look at this carefully, and I'll show you, part of the on the we call east bound, but that direction is entire on the field of the excavation material from the tunnel, and that one and the since the builder they start the next time. In other words, every year it's about 5 cm to 8 cm in the last 20-30 years. So the state of Colorado is very concerned because it's interstate. It's at the elevation. The particular location is at about elevation 3,000 meter something. 10,000 feet in the US, we talk about. And then it cannot stop because there's no alternative way. So it's very almost impossible to do some remediation. But meanwhile, every year, and people know, almost everybody drives through that, you know, this is the only way they can go to the east and west of the continent. And you will know that there's a name for that, called a big bomb. So the state of Colorado, every 5 years, when the settlement is so much, people start to complain, safety, they put the ash for it. And so after so many years, when we drilled the borehole there several years ago, the first 7 feet is all ash. Before we, 2 meters, over 2 meters, before we can see anything below that, it's all ash. So that's how much it is. But the big concern is why it happens, and can we do something better in the long-term solutions? So that's all part of the motivation. This is the cross section, and that's the highway. You know, you see that the geology of the site, and it's pretty thick, about up to 30 meters of the thick of the loose material and the weathered material on that particular size. And what happened is in the winter time, they accumulate a couple meters of the snow and put into the bank. But in the summer, beginning of the summer or spring, it can melt very fast. And we have done a borehole instrumentation where we can see the inclinometer to see where the where the landslide body is. And this shows that it's at a particular borehole, you can see that it's about 20 meters, and you have a larger displacement and season change. And so we've done this simple analysis, basically, so after we understand the local geology, and then we say, okay, let's do this 6 years scenario. Each year that we have three scenarios we examine here. Either melt 30 centimeter of water in 2 months, or 60 centimeter of water in 2 months, or 1 meter of water in 2 months. And as you see, that this big improvement. And we repeated that 6 years to see what is the response of the hydrologically and mechanically. And here is some of the simulation results about the pore pressure, it's the saturation and the suction stress. You can see that this is the first year, the configuration, there's quite a bit of suction on top. And then this is the April, which is before the starting of the melting. And then this is suction stress, pore pressure, suction stress. And the pore pressure, and this is June, so June is the melting after all the snow is completely disappeared. And you see that the larger dissipation of the pore pressure from negative to almost zero. And then the consequent of the suction stress disappears. And we can calculate the slope factor safety. Based on that, and you can calculate the corresponding effective stress first. And then the reduction of the suction stress due to this infiltration. Eventually, in this case, because we know the failure surface, we only conducted the classical method for the factor safety because along the failure surface. And you can see a couple calculation. The first one is how the pore pressure changes at a different location seasonally. And then the suction stress changes seasonally. And then the effective degree of saturation. Because once we know that, we can calculate the factor safety. So this is show the factor safety for different scenarios. And that one showed along the from the highway to all the way to the coast, along the failure surface, how the suction stress changes. So you can see that as infiltration increases, a lot of dissipation of the suction stress. Positive means forward pressure, so there's quite a bit of a couple meter of water table rise if you have a certain kind of scenarios, because it's converging. It's not just melting, also the up slope converging. But based on this one, you can see that after this multi-year cycle of the simulation, most likely, because there's a seasonal, it's somewhere between this fracture 1 meter to 0.6 centimeter. 6 centimeter will not reach 1.0, it's a little bit. But the 1 meter, definitely, there are considerable amount of time where the factor safety is or equal to 1, so you have a landslide curve. So these are the framework that I will present to you. With that, I'd like to make a few summary. One is the stress field based analysis demands great details into detail about the total stress, which is under gravity, and the pore pressure distribution, which requires the saturation and saturation framework of hydrology, water content distribution, as well as the suction stress. Because the suction stress, once you know all those information, then you can know the suction stress distributions. We have that, and then the suction stress is actually one of, in our view, is most powerful because it unifies the saturation and saturation framework in what we call the hydromechanic framework. But hydromechanic framework has been there by many of others. We just add a couple of ingredients. One of the ingredients is calculate the effectiveness correctly. The other one is how we calculate the total factor safety. It is introduced to realistically to describe the state of stress and to identify where the area is the most vulnerable. And I have to say that how they progress is still under research. It's beyond what our current framework can do, because that requires you to have an elastic model or the post-failure model, which I think belongs to the future. Particular people sitting here, students, to think about maybe you want to explore to them. So hydromechanical framework we call it is established as I show you here test, and we provide a unified way to advance quantitative of slope stability analysis of the infiltration. I say so because if you know that some quite a amount of work that people have done, they actually deviated from the classical geotechnical work, because they have to reinvent the stress theory, they have to reinvent the stress variable. I think that has inevitably create more parameters which is, could be quantified. And in this framework, we basically hydromechanical, they share the same kind of parameters. So we can go beyond easily. And also the method we use for factor safety, it move beyond one factor, one safety paradigms. So with that, I'd like to also show quite a few slides. First one is I want to talk about our current, this slide, just two slides. This slide shows our current program with the UNGS. And we are actually looking for postdoctoral PhD students to continue our project. And our project can summarize in several different state federal funding agents. We have a starting from early 90s, we started from Seattle. And then the last several years, decades, we have two sites in Oregon. Those are beautiful places if you want to go to explore that area. Every time my students favor, you know, they always want to go to the field. And the coastline is beautiful. So Oregon, we have one in Portland, which is near the border of Washington State, Oregon State. And it's a beautiful mountain. You can see the snow car, as well as the nice Oregon Trail. It's not too far away from there. And also in the south middle of Oregon, near Coors Bay, which is the another place where people doing landslide analysis, we call the risk core. That's the state forest. They have a timber industry cutting a lot of trees, so we are allowed to do a multi-year monitoring on those hillsides where they have a timber harvest. And then we start to do a California side, the UNGS landslide team. If people are familiar with the UNGS, the major team of landslide is located at the Calabria School Mine. But there are also a couple of other groups, a group in Portland or in Vancouver, Washington, that also doing a debris flow and volcano lake. And there's another group in near Stanford, Menlo Park, where they're also doing the problem in California. So we are working closely with them in the San Francisco Bay. We have ongoing, up to now we have six sites identified. And we'll go through this program, like test the material properly in the lab, and monitoring the field, and then go back to the modeling synthesis to push our the best of what we feel that the framework allows us to better understand landslide. And also we have the Calabria site here. It's ongoing, and we just start for another 3 years review of the project, and now already started. And then this NASA's side, which is East Coast. In the East Coast, as you see, this photograph is Appalachian Mountain. So in the East Coast, because the Atlantic Ocean every year create a lot of hurricanes for the continent, and most vulnerable is this mountain area where the moisture were trapped there and they have heavy storm. And so therefore, there are a lot of landslide. So we're working with the state of Carolina, and then NASA funded us to do a remote sensing using a multi-scale landslide framework and try to be able to not only just monitor but also in the future to be able to test some kind of regional model to predict the landslide. And also we are underway in Southern California as Christina has some great experience about the mountain and the LA Basin. And those are the areas also UHS already have the 45 people in the landslide team. Has done some work, but most of them are focused on the geomorphological, soil erosion, that kind of study. And we want to put those hydromechanics framework into the Southern California to continue our study. So that's pretty much the what I want to talk about. I really appreciate the great opportunity. If you are interested, you can look at the two books I wrote, which has a lot to do with what I've been doing for the last two decades. One is uncertain soil mechanics. The other one is the hillslope pathology. Finally, I want to show you guys two pictures. Allow me to. One that actually probably already see that, because I want to appreciate the opportunity. So this is the one. This is the one from my room. I took it first day of my check-in. So I really, this will be my memory, and this will keep me inspired to come back to Italy. So that's about the motivation. And the other one is I took about just 2 months ago at my home in Colorado. So this is my backyard. and you see the snow still in May. We see the
snow.
You wake up in the morning and then you get couple feet of snow. Great. And then by the middle of the day, most of them will be out. But that's the Calabria. Welcome. If you like it, you can come to Calabria. And that's another place that you don't want to miss it. Thank you very much.